first of all,
it's writing an obsession for you. Do you like need to write?
No, absolutely not. This is why I'm an oddity, because some writers are compulsive. Yeah. They can't have a fulfilled day unless they have been at their desk writing something, even if it gets torn up after that. You know, me, I have to be dragged to the desk. I really. I'm not a compulsive. I don't have a message for the human race. I don't really like the fame and the, you know, the publicity.
Why do you write?
Right, then? Money.
For the money.
I'm a mercenary. It's a living.
Your book now is called The Kill List. It's out in Norway and Sweden, and it's about a list of people that the government of the United States once killed.
Yeah, it exists. It's not fiction. It exists. It's there in the White House, and as they knock names,
they have this list.
Yeah, names get knocked off it when they get killed, and then fresh names like Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, who is the head of ISIL. Yeah. He's now well on it list. You know, they want him dead.
But how can you know there is such a list? Is it?
People talk.
Because it's not an official list.
No, it's not official, but it's there, and it is discussed every Tuesday morning between the president and six members of his inner cabinet, and they consider who now no longer applies because he's dead. Like the drone got him last week, Mr. President, so we can strike him off. But on the other hand, sir, I think we should put these two on. It's agreed.
Is it a rumour or is it true that you once took the part of an arms dealer and you said you were an arms dealer?
Arms buyer. I wanted to get inside the world of black market arms dealing, of which the capital then was Hamburg. So I went into Hamburg pretending to be a South African who had been commissioned by a multimillionaire in South Africa to buy weapons in Hamburg for an African coup d'etat. And that got me into the private conferences of the chief arms dealer of Hamburg, which was fine. I got all that I needed, how they work it, how they forge the documents, the end user certificate, which you have to present to your own government to get an export license to sell this stuff. Abroad, you know, and it was working fine. It was working fine. There was just one little problem, and I didn't realize it. The Jackal had just come out in German, and he was sitting in his limousine at a red light next to a bookshop window, and there was a display, and one of the books had fallen over, and on the back was the South African who was pretending to buy arms off him. And he went very, very mad indeed.
How did you get to know this?
I was in my hotel room and the phone rang. And fortunately, I had a friend. I didn't know I had a friend, but I had a friend also in the same world, because he had been commissioned by our government to see if they were selling any weapons to the IRA. So I didn't know who he was, but he knew who I was. And the phone rang and his voice said, "Get the hell out of Hamburg in about 5 minutes. Don't pack, just grab a passport and go." So I grabbed some money and a passport and ran across the station square through into the Hamburg main station, past the ticket office, just didn't buy a ticket, train leaving, doors closed, window open, went through the window, landed on top of a German businessman who was not amused. and then a ticket collector came and said, "Tickets, please." I said, "No ticket." He said, "Well, where are you going?" I said, "Where are you going?" He said, "Amsterdam." I said, "Do me fine, yeah." No. So I paid cash, a ticket to Amsterdam. And about 40 minutes later, they hit my hotel room, four of them.
You had a great fan in Margaret Thatcher.
And she had a sort of weakness for thriller novels. She liked to read one chapter before sleep. Every night, it took away all the strains of the day, just so. And I don't know who introduced her, but anyway, she liked to read one chapter every evening before bed. So when I learned this, it was suggested it might be nice to send her your next book, dedicated. So I did. Invitation round to Downing Street, Bang, bang, bang.
Bang, bang, bang.
Well, no, I mean... No. I mean, from that point on, we became friends.
You're a conservative yourself, of course.
Yeah.
But did she have a warmer side?
She did. People don't give her credit for that. She was very considerate of all serving staff. Now, if you see a real bastard in life, they usually, they smarm to their equals or superiors, but they treat the serving staff with contempt. Now, that's a coward, because the serving staff can't answer back. She wasn't like that. One young waitress spilled a whole tray of canapes and burst into tears, you know. And next thing, she put two foreign visiting presidents, pushed them to one side, went to comfort the girl, put her arm around her, led her to the kitchen. not many prime ministers do that.
Your life was as a reporter, and then you started to write books. You wrote The Jackal in like 35 days. Mm. You have the I mean, it's behind the Iron Curtain. It's like a movie. But were there romance? Were you like that kind of person?
I had one in Prague. I had to stay at one allowed hotel, the Yalta Hotel, and that had a disco in the basement, which is their idea of being cool. You know, I mean, very clumsy, not like a Western disco, but they thought they were cool. So after dinner, I would go down sometimes. I went down once, and there was this girl at the bar. God, she was good looking. I mean, this girl could stop traffic, you know. So I said, I'd like a drink, yes. A little dance, yes. And then about 1 a.m, they closed the place down. That's their idea of you know, a long night, 1 a.m. So we're just beginning in the West, getting moving at 1 a.m. So I went up with this girl, Jana. Her name was J-A-N-A, Jana. I went up to the pavement, it was stiflingly hot. I mean, it was a huge heat wave. But I couldn't go up to my room because there was a dragon on every landing outside the elevator doors. So that was out. So I had my car and I said, I tell you what, I know some lakes north of the city. Shall we go and swim? Oh, yes, yeah, nice idea. So
great,
I drove north to the lakes and parked by the edge of the lake. And we got out and we went down to the edge of the water and stripped down and went in the lake and swam for 30 minutes. Very, very nice, cool water, you know, stifling. And then we came out and we lay in the grass. And like healthy young animals, we made love. And afterwards, I was thinking, something's wrong about this evening. And I must have jerked or twitched or something, because a little sleepy voice by me said, what's the matter? I said, rearview mirror, no headlights. Where the hell are the STB? And the sleepy voice said, you just made love to it.
So she was
it was the secret police, yeah. So, her job was to tell the boys what I've been doing all evening. Well, she knew.
Frederick, it's great to have you here. Thank you so much.
I deliberately called it that to parallel climate change, because what I suggest in the book is the impact of the digital lifestyle, especially for younger people, is having as much impact, both good and bad, and it's as important.